Well, thanks for joining me this afternoon. My name is Suavek Zaja, and I work for Grand Parade, and we've been acquired by William Hill about 6 months ago, and we're working on some interesting problems. So my hope for this talk, which is going to be fairly generic to a point, is to describe some of the challenges that we're facing in this industry of gaming and betting. However, at some point, I hope to dive a little bit deeper into one problem area that we're trying to address. And at the towards the end of the presentation, I want to talk about some of the things that we're building going forward. So I want to give you a little bit of an overview of what gaming and betting is all about. There are many metaphors that we can draw, comparing it to financial industry and the gaming industry. But I feel like if I give you an overview, you're going to get a better understanding of what problems we're actually trying to solve and why some of the principles of good software architecture and good design are really important for us, because some problems really come to the surface at scale. And I want to have a bit of a discussion about a betting approach that we took with actors and some of the results that came out of that. And towards the end, I want to talk about where we're going in the future. So gaming and betting. Does anybody know how Zeus came to rule Mount Olympus and eventually the Earth? It was actually a bet. Zeus had a bet with Hades and Poseidon, and he won the bet. It was probably some kind of straws or dice. But even as of 40,000 years ago, there was dice that was found with foragers. So the activity of betting and gaming has been around with us for a long time. But obviously, in today's world, things have changed a little bit. You know, the stakes are definitely a little bit different. And as you may know, people play poker, they play blackjack, and then there's betting with casinos and slots. But what I want to focus on today is betting on sports, because it has a number of interesting challenges. And certainly in terms of the data flow, in terms of how information flows from the back end, how it's analyzed at the back end, it's really a giant publish-subscribe system as well. So we're going to talk about a little bit about some of that. So let me talk a little bit about the data flow from my favorite sport, which happens to be tennis. So I watched the Australian Open about a week ago, and it was a very interesting match. I'm a big fan, and it was highly emotional. And Federer is, you know, in the fifth set, and he's losing. And according to all indications, he was probably going to lose the match. And certainly, the statistical analysis and all the algorithms and all the odds were against him at the time. In the fifth set, but lo and behold, he broke and he ended up winning the match. But from our point of view, from the view of our industry, there's really little emotion there. It's all about the numbers. So each point is actually keyed in by the chair umpire, and then it gets processed and fed into the back-end systems. It gets further processed and then gets fed into a trading platform that then, in real time, analyzes the price against simulations and then adjusts the price slightly. So while emotions are running high, for us it's all about analysis and data and crunching the numbers. So when you see a point that lasts about 2 seconds, during these 2 seconds, you see data traversed from the back end to the user website and price being adjusted. So there's a lot of things that are happening behind the scenes. So let's talk a little bit about the data and things that we're looking into. So for us, you know, it really starts with events. We're processing various events, various sports, whether it be tennis, football, or horse betting. And we need to do something with those events. These events can be internal or external, so from third-party providers. There's a lot of third-party providers that provide all kinds of data for live events. So we need to get those events and aggregate those events into feeds. And we move about 160 terabytes of data a day. That's quite a bit for us. Obviously, we have a lot of business processes. Some of them are quite critical because there are financial transactions and people bet with real money. So we have some business processes that have to generate other events, but also we have to move those processes further to the users. So we have about 5 million price changes per day. That may not seem like a lot, because if you're a high-frequency trader, you do way, way more than that. But for us, it's a lot, because it all happens during a very, very narrow window, short window of time. So let's say a football match on Saturday. Most of these price changes will be during one very important football match. And then we obviously have consumers, whether it be website users or mobile users or native apps. And they generate events further. So we process about 500 bets a second. Once again, this is it's a very peaky business, so it will all happen during a short window of time. So we have something we call the ephemeral markets. So these are 1-minute markets or 5-minute markets. So these are really gamified bets. So something that gets created for what will happen in the next 5 minutes. So as you can tell, that creates a whole bunch of other technical problems. And as I mentioned, our business is quite peaky. So without kind of hammering the reactive manifesto, because I'm sure you all know it, I just want to kind of talk through what some of those things mean to us. Because our users really expect a gamified experience. They want this experience to be immersive. They can't tolerate any delays, or they will go to the competition. So for us, and as I describe some of the systems later, we have to calculate the precise response times for each component, and we have to have tracing in each of our components. As we're, even as we're starting the implementation, we're already thinking about logging and tracing and measuring the response times and latencies. Additionally, it's really a trust-based business, right? People bet with real money. They expect their transactions to go through. They expect when the bet is resulted and then settled, they expect to get the money. So they can't tolerate any failure. We need to isolate our failures, and we can't show them to the users. Last thing, we need to be profitable. And obviously, we have to adopt certain principles for that. And because we're a global business, we have to go with availability first. So we will be eventually consistent, but availability is critical for us. And as we scale, we have to, because of the peaky nature, we have to scale elastically. So sometimes the traffic on Monday, or Tuesday or Wednesday, could be very slow, but on a Saturday or during certain months like Grand National Horse Betting, it's going to be astronomical in comparison. So that's where elasticity is really important. Just a little bit about, because we're so heavily focused on feeds, and we're feeds business. What helps in terms of how we're thinking about it is kind of the old school Unix approach, right? We have these different feeds. We have to be able to compose them. We need very simple interfaces between different components. However, we have to do this in a distributed system. So we're heavily reliant on Kafka for durability. We have all kinds of audits happening on our systems, and we have to be able to present to a gambling commission exactly what transactions happened during what time window. So everything is recorded in our business, and we could be audited at any point in time. So here's an example of how we would be composing various feeds to calculate settlements. So for example, we would take bets, prices, and results, and then we would crunch the numbers and settle the results. Another example, which is actually quite interesting, is we took event feeds from both tennis and football, and what we did was we ran it through statistical analysis, and we created a product which we called Momentum, which is kind of an emotional, what we call an emotional counterpart to what the score actually shows you. So which player has the momentum? So it was our way of, you know, taking something that's already existing and getting that into another product and showing users something extra. So let's say you're walking by a TV screen, you're looking at the score and it's 0-0, it doesn't really tell you much, but something like Momentum may tell you that one team is significantly, has got the momentum more than the other. So what we did was we got all the events, we aggregated them, we had some weighting based on the events, and we did some training, and we ran it through a number of case studies, and we came up with the numbers. So I want to dive a little bit into one particular problem that we faced and how we approached it, and that's a betting engine. So this is really a core of the betting business, and it needs to evolve. So you can see the state machine, and so it goes through a number of stages. A user can place a bet, and then the bet has to be accepted by the system. So for example, a user places a bet at a certain value, the system has to confirm, yes, I'm able to accept your bet. So then there's a product that was probably introduced a few years ago, where now in this highly competitive business, you can change your mind. So that means, let's say I bet, 100 złoty, and suddenly I'm like, well, I don't think Federer can win the match, so I'll just cash in for, let's say, 90 złoty and give up. And that creates a whole bunch of technical problems, because then you have to recalculate what the bet is actually worth in real time and present it to the user. So that's yet another thing that has to be done. When the actual event completes, the results come in. And as soon as the results come in, we have to process the results and we have to settle the bet, meaning pay the money. And so this is quite challenging at an event like Grand National, where there are millions and millions of users betting all at the same time, and they're betting mostly on similar things. So I want to kind of dive a little bit deeper into an actor model case study that we've done, because traditionally, when you look at a workflow such as this, the first kind of implementation, as it is with most systems, is kind of putting your data in a relational database. But because there's a lot of data that's related from different sources, you will end up doing a lot of joins, and you will have to do them quite frequently. So relational databases normally die under very, very heavy workflow in these situations. So this was really an opportunity for us to kind of take a look at the actor model and just try to understand it and try to see if we can kind of model this problem using actors. So we did that. So here's a simple, kind of a simplified example of, let's say there's a horse race, the horse name is Erlang, and the selection is, I bet on Erlang to win. So in this case, the selection would be the supervisor, and an individual bet would be, let's say Joe bets on Erlang, that would be the individual bet. And that's how, that was the first approach of how we modeled this kind of an implementation. This is how it would look if there was, let's say, two selections. There are two horses now, Erlang and Scala, and Joe bets on Erlang, and Fred kind of is unsure because he likes JVM and he's kind of functional, so he will bet on Scala and Erlang. And then, you know, Martin only bets on Scala, right? So, so this is yet a simplified example. Now, let's expand this kind of way of thinking and see how it would look at an event such as Grand National. So for a selection such as Erlang, let's say it's a very popular horse, there will be now 250 users betting on that. So we would have 250 actors to supervise. And this would all be stored in memory. So we ran this simulation and we kind of crunched the numbers and here were the results. So for about 10 million processes, and that was done in Erlang, so for 10 million processes in a virtual machine, we had about 65 gigabytes of RAM. And so vertically, it was concurrency was very, very good, and there was really good vertical scalability. However, there was a big problem, and I can talk a little bit after the session about, you know, some of the details of this problem, but we had way too many messages going through at the time of settlement, and we had no way to kind of manage the number of messages, because for each selection there could be thousands of them. We could potentially have millions of messages going. So supervision was also really hard. Supervising 250,000 children, it turns out to be problematic. And so we looked at a number of approaches, including sharding, fundamentally, there was a realization that this problem was probably not modeled in the right way, and maybe we didn't really use actors the right way, and so we kind of decided that you know, we should look at something different, that we should probably treat actors as units of computation, not maintain the state between the supervisor and the actors for such a long time. So our second approach was to have a group of actors per node, and then a selection would essentially spawn a number of actors and would use the distributed cache to process the bets. So this turned out to be a much better approach for us, and it's likely the way forward with some corner cases to be solved, which I can discuss later. The usage of RAM was much less, and we have much better scalability. There are some tricky edge cases to solve, and we have an approach of how we would go about solving it, but this is likely what we're going to be doing going forward. Now, what I want to do next is that, you know, this is an example of a problem that we, you know, we've approached, we've faced, and we've solved, and we have a good understanding of how we want to solve it. But then there's yet another problem, and what could be another problem to solve in our industry, and that's personalization. So everybody is thinking about personalization right now, and you know, you want to understand your users, their patterns, and what they're doing. For us, it's also really important to understand that. So we had another R&D project, and this one was actually in Scala, Akka, and using Spark. And it's well described on the Lightband website. It was classic Lambda architecture. And basically, the architect of the system was a big fan of Greek mythology, so he named it Omnia. And we had a batch layer, a speed layer, and a serving layer. But what these two problems and how we approach them really show us is that for us, we need to start thinking about a platform, because when we solve an individual problem, we will end up solving, yet another problem, perhaps in a slightly different way. So we realized we need to have, you know, a common platform for solving our problems. So this is really our challenge, is how do you, you know, reason about these problems that are highly complex and provide a common platform. So that, for example, with betting and personalization, I may want to do anomaly detection. What would that mean? Let's say there's a number of bets that are happening and they're highly suspicious. In our business, there are some players that constantly try to kind of beat the system. They will have some statistical algorithms and they will try to do something tricky. And so we have to be able to detect that. And so this is yet another thing that we would need to add. And we wouldn't want it to be an island of itself. So we need to kind of enable services and composability and maintain consistent design principles as we're going forward. So what we're doing next is really thinking about a platform we can build a baseline and then extend our services. So this is kind of a very, very, very high level view of what we're building. And we've decided our stack is actually going to be Scala and Akka for the message fabric itself. We're quite open for some of the business domain to be in whatever different language, whether it be Java, Node.js, or Erlang or whatnot. But essentially, this kind of approach and what we're starting to build here in Krakow now is what's really helping us to extend the platform even further. So we don't want just yet another personalization service or another solution for something else. We want to build a platform. So we want to think about domain-driven design from the business domain and kind of isolate components into bounded context and kind of have a common language for speaking about all of that. So some of the key considerations for us is that this is quite a large project, and many of you may have heard about Conway's Law, but essentially it refers to the structure of your organization. But I like the reverse in that if you don't think about Conway's Law, then whatever the architecture of your system is going to be, that's how your teams are going to end up looking. So the other interesting thing that I like about it is if you have four different teams building a compiler, then you're going to get a four-pass compiler. There was an interesting quote being given on that. So we really have to think about, okay, we're going to build the platform, but how are we going to design our teams? I mean, it's something that as software designers we don't think about it because we have distributed teams. We're thinking we're going to get a developer here, developer there. We're going to kind of build it. But for us, it's really important to kind of reason about it in a very structured way. And we've also adopted certain principles and CQRS and CQRS, whatever we need to optimize. And event sourcing. Why event sourcing, right? Everything for us is audited. We have to be able to show all the flow of events. So it's a no-brainer for us. But again, as you have a big, big team, you have to make sure that everybody upholds these principles in the organization. And we've chosen Scala. And we've been doing development in Scala in Krakow here for about a year. And it turns out to be quite a challenging language. We've had a number of actual courses given within our organization. Some people came out scratching their heads saying, I will never code in this, I don't understand this. So we have to learn continuously. And sometimes, we're we're only as good as, you know, the whole team, right? So if you have a superstar developer that just kind of goes off a tangent and starts using monads everywhere, and then nobody can understand the code, that would be a big challenge for us. And so we have to kind of get a common baseline across everyone and just, you know, think about this in terms of our processes and frameworks. And my kind of last point on this slide, which is ironic that I said that front end cannot be an afterthought, but it's kind of the last point. But you know, we all, you know, this is primarily a conference with backend developers. We love backends. But front end is where your data shows, where you know, where you're showing it to the users. And especially in recent years, with the emergence of React and Redux, things are changing a little bit on the front. So I think we're taking a look at that, and it's quite interesting how some of the front end technology and the approach is modeling some of the back end. And where that is interesting is that suddenly your middleware is not as thick because you're using similar frameworks on the front end and on the back end. So for example, there's even a concept of sagas now on the front end. So long-running workflows, and it's slightly different than what we have on the back end. But we're really trying to kind of think about front end first as well, because where it's important is in some of our publish and subscribe implementations, where how do we manage all the subscriptions for all the price updates, right? Do we have it somewhere in the middleware? Probably not. We would not want to keep that on the middleware. We would want each individual client to subscribe to the actual events that that they're interested in, and then that would be cached somewhere. So that's something that's highly important for us. So this was what I thought was going to be 20-minute talk, and I'll open up for a Q&A, and hopefully if you're interested in one of those areas to kind of elaborate a little bit further, and I'm happy to talk about it. We also have some of our architects and developers here that may explain some of the things that we're doing in a little bit more detail. Thank you.
So this time we have really lots of time for Q&A. So who wants to come first?
Last row there. There was a first row. Yeah.
Thank you. Are you going to stick to existing Scala stack, for example, for Kafka, for Cassandra, K-persistence, or are you going to create yet another library?
No. Our approach is to use open source as much as possible, to use what's already there. We do not want to reinvent the wheel. So Cassandra, Akka cluster, you know, this is definitely the wrong approach. I used to work a lot. I used to work in the past for BlackBerry, and we used to have our own proprietary systems, and they were the greatest thing for a number of years, until the community caught up, and then you kind of find yourself behind the curve. So open source as much as possible. And then where you want to kind of add value is something that's very specific to your domain that nobody else understands at the level of detail. For example, betting, right? We are never going to be, you know, experts in like persistence or managing a cluster. We don't want to build a cluster. There was a question at the back there.
Exactly. Okay, just one moment.
Yeah. Okay, can you, yeah. So thank you for your presentation. And you say that you are basically learning Scala and all of these things going on with it, mm-hmm. with in-house training and so on. And were you not afraid that you will build something that in a few years will be unsustainable and it will be hard to maintain because of your, well, you're just starting in Scala. You don't know all of the features.
True. That's a really good point. And at some point, any company has to kind of make that decision, right? Do you go with something that you know and understand, like Java, that's been around for a long time, and or do you go with new technology? And I think the key thing is to fail fast, right? So we had a project, and we implemented something, and it didn't really go as well as we hoped it would. And we learned from that. So it was, you know, and then we're iterating on that. So I think that's really the key for us, to really get to a baseline as a team, right? So the decision for Scala is, it's not something that that it's totally experimental, right? Like people are using it and it's working, and we know it's working in certain implementations of ours, right? So it's a matter of really growing as a team. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. One more.
Thank you for the talk. What led you to choose Scala? You talked about Erlang. Well, like, why did you use Erlang? Why did you go to Scala?
Yeah, well, was not an easy decision. It's primarily a decision. It's not really a language decision. It's more a platform decision. So what I mean is that there's a culture and of an enterprise culture, and there are tools and processes that people are already familiar with. So if you do a lot of stuff in Java, which we've been doing Java for a long time, you know, the languages themselves are different, right? But it's still a JVM platform. So it's a platform we're familiar with. And so that's what the decision is. I should also point out that we're not going away from Java. The Java will be used in many, many places, that only certain components are going to be developed in Scala.
I would like to ask if you have some requirements or metrics how fast the data should flow through your system. For example, how quickly you display the odds in the front end or something like that.
Yes, we do. However, that, you know, the envelope gets pushed, right? And so it's not really, I can't really, you know, give like a straight answer saying, you know, this is, obviously we want to be as fast as we can, right? But we're almost to some degree going backwards. So we're kind of trying to measure the latencies of communication between the different components and trying to work backwards to saying, like, can we provide these guarantees, right? So there's a lot of learning going on in doing that, but there are numbers behind it. But don't ask me to name them off the top of my head.
One more.
Uh, You said that the relational database was not the best fit for your use
yes.
case.
Yes.
So I would like to know where do you store your data or which kind of storage do you use?
We'll use Cassandra.
Cassandra, okay.
Yes.
We still have time for more.
There's one more question here at the front.
Okay.
You're saying about components of your system. Is it microservices or just internal?
Microservices are the domain. So in this here, in this business domain, it's all microservices.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, cool. And the second question is how you do communication between these components, through Akka or maybe some Thrift? Kafka or maybe some Swift protocol or HTTP?
Through Akka, yes.
I mean, through Kafka?
Yes, Kafka and Akka, yes.
Oh, okay, thank you.
And one more here.
Yes, still in the technical questions. I've seen Cassandra for data store. And what do you do? What do you use for view models? How do you build view models? I've seen the CQRS, the read side.
So we're considering a number of things. Right now we're currently using React, right? But I don't know if we're going to be using that going forward. So we haven't really gotten to the level, like I said, front end is not an afterthought, but you know, we're not there yet. But when we get there, I think we're going to use something equivalent.
Yeah, and I don't know if there are confidential details or not, but the view models are built from the journals or you know, combining few journals or some like else?
I can't really talk about the implementation because we haven't really gotten to the view models yet.
Thanks.
Okay, and another one. Hey, question, because you're dealing with money, so you probably, I assume, needs to assure some level of transactionality.
Yes.
How are you dealing with it with Kafka and, as you said, eventually consistent microservice environment?
Yes. Well, I mean, yes. Well, Kafka is very durable, right? So we have to kind of have messaging contracts and at least once messaging item policy and at least once messaging. But then persisting the data into Cassandra and you know, being eventually consistent and obviously that can sound scary, but if you have, if you're within one data center, you can almost close to guarantee that you're really consistent, right? So so yes, if we went with a database that's kind of a relational database, and we went with ACID, we would have those guarantees, but we wouldn't have the availability. So. So we're going to get as close as we can within the 99.99 percentile, but you know, there is that element, right, and of a particular failure. But the question is weighing the probability of those failures against something else. So yes, we are almost like a bank, but ATM systems and Visa and other systems also do the same thing. So I think this is really this where scalability is key.
So we're talking about eventual consistency not only in case of data regarding the odds or the bets presented to users, but also the input from users, their
yes.
bets.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, that was a very good Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you.